Hello everyone, welcome back to the series An Introduction to 2D Materials, Episode 1, Part 2. In this section, we'll go over the remainder of the exfoliation methods, starting with exfoliation onto the surface of polymers. If you haven't seen Part 1 yet, please go and check it out first. Now, the next series of techniques is an adaptation of the tape to silicon dioxide methods. Instead of exfoliating to something rigid like silicon dioxide, these methods are based on exfoliation onto polymer coatings, which are relatively softer in comparison to silicon dioxide. Thanks to the compressibility of polymers in comparison to silicon dioxide, the flakes tend to stay on the polymer coatings better than silicon dioxide. The first of this method is shown here, where a 2D material is exfoliated onto PMMA. In between the PMMA and the substrate, however, there is another layer of polymer which gets selectively removed in water. This polymer is called AquaSave, which was first developed as a discharge layer for e-beam lithography, and it is used here as a water-soluble layer. But things like PVA, PVP, or Electro-92, which are all soluble in water, can also be used. So once the exfoliation onto PMMA is successful and a viable flake is identified, the substrate is let go in a water bath. Then water seeps in between the PMMA and the substrate, dissolving away the AquaSave or equivalent polymer layer. And the relatively less dense PMMA film is then left afloat on water, which can then be scooped up with a glass slide with a hole drilled through. And this flake can then be deterministically transferred using micromanipulators. This was the first method used to make heterostructures of graphene and HBN. Similarly, in this work, they used PPC as a polymer layer. Using the optical principles discussed before, they optimized the contrast of graphene and HBN on PPC-coated silicon-silicon dioxide. Interesting thing here is that PPC doesn't adhere so well to silicon-silicon dioxide as PMMA does, so one can simply peel off the PPC layer from the substrate and transfer that onto a glass slide with PDMS block on top. After carefully positioning the flake above a substrate, in this case another HBN flake, the flake is made to contact the substrate while heating up beyond the glass transition temperature of PPC, above which the film becomes soft. By retracting the glass slide at this elevated temperature, only the flake is left behind with very little residues. Next up is PDMS. PDMS is used a lot in various parts of science because it is so versatile. In 2D material research, it has become an invaluable tool and every lab should have it in their arsenal. Because PDMS is a thermoset resin, not a thermoplastic, it doesn't reflow like PC or PVC. It has a glass transition at negative 150 degrees Celsius, but handling them above the glass transition temperature, for example at room temperature, is easy and doesn't lead to sticky situations. This paper by Andres Castellanos Gomez et al. Was developed in Delft, and it has been the bread and butter exfoliation and transfer method for me and my colleagues. It is particularly powerful when making suspended structures out of 2D materials. In this method, the tape with a 2D material is exfoliated onto a block of PDMS, which is attached to a glass slide. The key here is to be as fast as possible when removing the tape. Similar to the inertia experiments, with a ball with two strings, more 2D materials are left behind the faster you accelerate the tape away. If you pull away the tape slowly, most of the flakes will remain on the tape. This can also be useful when repossessing the precious 2D crystals from the PDMS back onto the tape. PDMS can be acquired in general two ways. First is by purchasing the silicone elastomer kits from chemical companies like Dow Corning. Sold under the name CellGuard 184 or similar products, the PDMS elastomer kit comes in two bottles. The big bottle is the base, and the small bottle is the curing agent. What you do is you mix the two ingredients in a ratio of 10 to 1 by weight and cure it so that it hardens into PDMS. The ratio can be modified to change the stickiness and the mechanical properties. I find that this method of producing PDMS is slightly cleaner than the commercial version. I recommend that you properly degas the mixture by pumping on it and let it cure in ambient conditions in a flat container. This way, gravity can do its job to settle the film so that the resulting film is flat on both sides. The commercial version of the PDMS is sold under the name Gel Film from Gel Pack. They come in various tack levels and thicknesses. The standard number is 4, which has medium tack, and with this, finding a monolayer is quite easier than the homemade version of the PDMS. However, the commercial gel films can be quite expensive compared to the elastomer kit. Also, I find that these tend to be easier to work with, but tend to be a bit dirtier than the homemade version. There are several ways in which the notorious residues can be reduced, but that's perhaps a topic for another day. Moving on to the next section, now I will be listing the exfoliation using metal or dielectric deposition. There are several mechanisms at play, such as interfacial strain, chalcogen-gold interaction, and electron doping from the metal. These methods have been extremely successful, and there have been many variations of these methods being reported because they tend to allow researchers to exfoliate ginormous monolayer flakes, even reaching centimeters or whatever the size of the mother crystal is. In this paper, a thick layer of gold is evaporated directly onto the bulk crystal. Then, by using a thermal release tape, the gold layer, along with the topmost monolayer, is peeled away from the bulk crystal. Then the monolayer is made contact with a dummy substrate of choice and heated to release the thermal release tape. Finally, the gold is selectively etched away in a KI solution. The improvement in the yield is impressive with this method, and I have had great success with this method as well, personally. I've tried many of the gold-assisted exfoliation methods, and this is by far the easiest to implement and yields in large areas of monolayer flakes. Here are a few tricks which should be considered. 1. After the thermal release tape is removed, do not touch the surface of gold even with gloves. Depending on the quality of gloves, residues can be left behind which remain even after the KI step, and the finger imprint on your sample is, in general, to be avoided. Use something clean to press down if needed. 2. After the thermal release tape is removed, plasma clean the tape residues away thoroughly. 3. KI solutions are salt solutions, and if rinsing is done poorly, it leaves salt crystals behind which tend to be difficult to redissolve. So instead of taking out the chip from the KI solution, I suggest to dilute the solution with DI until it becomes clear. Next is a variation of the same method, but instead of evaporating the gold onto the bulk crystal directly, which has been shown to cause a lot of defects in TMDs, the gold is evaporated onto an atomically flat silicon substrate, and then the tape is brought into contact. In the left paper, they evaporated only a few nanometers of gold on top of silicon with an adhesion layer and directly exfoliated onto the gold surface. What they found out was that, interestingly, within a few minutes of being exposed to air, the adhesion between the gold surface and the TMDs quickly diminished. The paper on the right evaporated gold on top of silicon without any adhesion layer, which allows the gold layer to be peeled away. The ingenious thing here is that since the gold is evaporated onto something atomically flat, the bottom surface of the gold film that is peeled away is itself atomically flat. This flat gold is then used to exfoliate from the topmost surface of a bulk crystal and transferred onto a new substrate. The following works showed that not only can you transfer chalcogenides, which are known to be reactive to gold, you can also use the interfacial strain as a way to peel off the layers. There are several works, but I will show you these three for now. First is the work on peeling away epitaxially grown graphene from silicon carbide. Here, they used nickel as an adhesion layer to peel off graphene from silicon carbide, which was quite a difficult task 10 years ago. The work on the bottom uses a dielectric, aluminum oxide, to peel off iron germanium telluride. This is quite exciting because the other methods used conductors to exfoliate the material, which mandated the removal of the metallic layers in order to conduct transport measurements. But here, since they use a dielectric, one can leave the dielectric layer and keep it on for the transport measurements. Finally, this work used the Li method. I wish it was named after me, but it's not. It is called the layer-engineered exfoliation method. They used the same technique used for TMDs, but on graphene, to show that millimeter-scale graphene exfoliation is possible. Furthermore, depending on the choice of the metal deposited, the strain between the metal and the graphite can be controlled, such that the selective exfoliation of monolayer or bilayer are achieved. They also showed that the resulting graphene films still have pristine electronic and phononic properties. The last class of exfoliation methods deal with non-van der Waals materials. These are interesting because they allow non-2D systems to be integrated into 2D heterostructures. In the beginning, I said that I will leave the liquid phase exfoliation of 2D materials for another day, but I thought I'd mention this here since this is not the large-scale production of graphene-like systems. Using a liquid as a medium, bulk crystals of 3D materials can be broken down into their monolayer form. The left paper shows the isolation of alpha hematite into its monolayer form by sonication in DMF. Similarly, the works on the right are the liquid phase exfoliation of complex oxides strontium ruthenate and calcium ruthenate. The Ruddleston Popper phases with n not equal to infinity have cleaving planes, allowing the preferential breaking of crystals along that plane. These two papers used that to produce the ultra-thin flakes. In the case of calcium ruthenate, extraordinary thing happened where the material, which in the bulk form is a Mott insulator, transitioned to a superconductor in the thin form. So, in my opinion, this is a new avenue of research which was not possible before, and we can expect many great discoveries to emerge from this line of research. Next up are methods using sacrificial layers during epitaxy. In these works, researchers use sacrificial layers to epitaxially grow the quasi-2D films on top and later peel away the grown layers. These are really cool techniques because since they are based on epitaxy, the resulting films are high quality, large scale, and the number of layers can be accurately controlled. The paper on the left uses sacrificial water-soluble ceramic called strontium aluminate, which itself can epitaxially be grown on top of strontium titanate. Then, without breaking vacuum, the crystal of choice can be epitaxially grown on top. After growth, the film of interest can be released from the growth substrate by submerging the sample in water. Polymer films such as PDMS, PMMA, or PPC can be used to hold the flakes together in place while being submerged. I have used this technique for several works I've co-authored and had great success. The paper on the right uses double-layer graphene transferred on top of the growth substrate as a sacrificial layer. Interestingly, the double-layer graphene is epitaxially transparent, such that the overlayers follow the crystallinity of the underlying substrate, completely ignoring the graphene. After growth, the van der Waals nature of the graphene allows the film grown on top to be easily removed. Techniques such as these allow the integration of quasi-2D complex oxide films into van der Waals heterostructures, which, unlike 3D heterostructures, don't require the crystallinity of the individual layers to be locked to that of the underlying crystal. With that, I would like to conclude the second part of episode 1, the exfoliation and transfer methods. Today we finished the exfoliation method, and from next time we'll go over the transfer methods.